I'm proud of our state, I'm proud of our governor.
When Governor Round signed 1215 into law and then disavowed ownership of it, I was so angry. 3 days after that, I changed party affiliation.
The stories would change every day at the Capitol. He's gonna sign it tomorrow. Oh, he's not gonna sign it.
I knew he would have a lot of pressure to sign it. I was not surprised. I was disappointed.
When the governor called and said that he was signing the bill, in my own mind I went, oh my God, it's gonna start.
Legalized abortion on demand has been an unprecedented moral catastrophe for our country. In the last 33 years since Roe, almost 50 million human beings have been killed, not by war, famine, or disease, but by the decision of their own parents, with the sanction of our highest court. That's 1/6 of the population of our country.
It is, in my opinion, the greatest equal protection challenge facing this country today.
Circulating petitions again.
There was a huge outcry amongst progressive people to circulate petitions and get this on the ballot and repeal it.
We need to get it on the ballot so that the people of South Dakota can vote on it.
People came out of the woodwork to speak up.
1215 is not the result of somebody just waking up one morning and saying, this is what we're going to do. We have been moving in this direction.
South Dakota, in my view, is a fairly conservative state, but it's not the conservatism of the southern United States. It's a cowboy conservatism.
In 2006, South Dakota voters became the first Americans to visit the polls in an election and cast ballots on abortion. In this tiny red state, an all-out ban on abortions easily passed in the state legislature. Approval was much harder to come by amongst the populace, whose conservatism has a wide libertarian streak. To understand what happened in 2006, we need to start with another abortion ban that passed the South Dakota legislature in 2004.
The reason we're talking about this abortion ban today in South Dakota is because of one legislator. This wasn't on the radar screen for anybody. It was Matt McCauley who one day said, I'm tired of waiting for somebody to do something to overturn Roe versus Wade.
Back when I was in law school, I was first reading the Roe versus Wade opinion, and even in college and looking into the abortion issue and how it had become accepted in terms of today's society, really very frustrated with the fact that this had been an issue for the courts and not for the people.
In January 2004, Matt McCauley unleashed his abortion ban proposal on the South Dakota Capitol and on the nation. He wanted to introduce the bill a year earlier, but had been persuaded to thoroughly research the issue first.
I contacted out-of-state groups for assistance with doing that. However, it was my idea. I just didn't, as an individual legislator, have all the resources that I needed to have access to the medical experts, the legal experts, the factual witnesses.
As I proceeded into my teenage years, I became very sexually active.
The kinds of things that you need to adequately prepare for a significant piece of legislation. So I went to places like the Thomas More Law Center, National Right to Life, the South Dakota Family Policy Council. I went to a variety of churches, pastors. I consulted with a number of doctors locally, here, nationally, DNA experts, anybody that would talk to me and asked, how can we draft the best legislation possible? Called some of the national groups and said, give me some model legislation. There wasn't any. I was told that there was a plan. Someone said there was a master nationwide plan, one of these secret plans to overturning Roe versus Wade. I'm convinced such a thing does not exist.
McCulley's House Bill 1191 sought to ban abortion except, quote, to preserve the life of the pregnant woman, or if there is a serious risk of substantial and irreversible impairment of a major bodily function, end quote. It was a full frontal attack on Roe versus Wade. McCulley shrewdly enlisted the vast majority of his colleagues as co-sponsors of his bill. That blunted the impact when South Dakota's longest-standing anti-abortion group opposed his effort.
When House Bill 1191 was introduced, we had two-thirds of the House as co-sponsors on the bill and a majority of the South Dakota Senate on the bill. National Right to Life was not excited about the idea. They did not believe that the time was right.
McCulley's abortion ban was the cleaver that split the pro-life community. The abortion ban was a rallying cry for those losing patients with the painstaking strategy of gradually dismantling Roe versus Wade.
For 34 unfortunate years, abortion has been a scourge on American society.
The pro-life community is certainly of two divergent opinions.
It has claimed nearly 50 million lives and has adversely affected millions of women and families.
In 2004, there was a bitter divide that existed here in the state of South Dakota.
You definitely could feel the separation in the Republican Party.
The movement was underfoot. You could see it. You could just tell.
The people in the state of South Dakota over these last 15 years have been sending to peer a gradually increasing number of very vocal pro-life legislators.
There is nothing spontaneous about this issue. We could have had this legislation 8 years ago, 7 years ago, but it would have never been allowed.
About 12 years ago, 14 years ago, there were pro-choice majorities in both the state House and the state Senate. Many of them, the most influential leaders in the legislature, both Democrat and Republican, were pro-choice. Lost seats in the 94 elections, we lost seats in the 96 elections, we lost them again in the 98 elections. If you look at a bar graph of Democrats in the legislature, you could pretty much see a downward spiral. It just goes down and down and down. Every 2 years, we would lose more and more seats in either the state Senate, the state House, or both.
The pressure on legislators is significant, coming not only from the lobbyists, but they have a very well-organized network of constituents all across the state who are constantly calling and emailing, writing letters, contacting their legislators in every way to put pressure on them, to encourage them to vote against abortion rights.
Those folks that support an all-out ban on abortions, with exception for the health or for the life of the mother, have been working for a number of years to make sure that they've gotten candidates on the ballot, both at the local level and specifically at the state level. They've also worked very hard to make sure that, especially within the Republican Party, that those folks that are precinct men and women are very much pro-life. You know, that's just part of the political game.
You can drive down the street and see the signs one after the other. From judge to senator are listed together and working together.
It felt almost sometimes like they were trying to get there for one purpose and one purpose only, and that was to, you know, push this to the point that it got pushed and get it on the governor's desk for a signature.
A key Republican says South Dakota's anti-abortion movement was infused with energy during an intense election in 2002.
The White House political operation really was focused on 2004, but they wanted to tune up the organizations in 2002. South Dakota was the test market for the 72-hour get-out-the-vote program. Obviously, we all know what happened in Florida, and Karl Rove, at the conclusion of when the president was sworn in and set out to do the roadmap to remake America Republican. Had a natural allies in the evangelical movement. We reached out to them.
The national Republican machinery and money swept across South Dakota and, Rosenthal says, shifted the prairie's political landscape.
They pumped in a lot of money, $7-8 million, built a big organization like the Republicans have never seen in South Dakota before. They brought 6,000 or 7,000 people into this. Even though John Thune lost the 2002 election, they felt very energized.
As we sit here today, the first time I've heard anybody link the 04 ban bill with the 02 election is today.
I was in high school and college prior to Roe v. Wade. Other women my age were as well. We all heard, you know, if you didn't have a personal experience close to you, still heard the stories of illegal and botched abortions you heard. But you also knew the stories of families who could afford to put their daughter on a plane and go somewhere. And the rumors were there, and then, of course, she's back. And we all, myself included, had experiences where we went into, whether it be a classroom or an employer, to look at you and say, my experience was a bank manager saying, we don't put women in our management trainee program. Well, there has been so much progress that women my daughter's age cannot imagine anyone ever saying that. I think maybe this ban has done two things. For those of us who knew what it was like with women's reproductive freedom years ago, know those stories, know why these changes occurred in the first place. They thought their work was done, and they're saying, no, it isn't. And I think the women that are my daughter's ages, younger women, have realized, whoa, these things aren't things you can take for granted. Whether it's abortion if needed, or whether it's contraception, or whether it's denied employment, these things we can't take for granted. Women have to, men and women in this country and certainly in our state, have to be paying attention.
South Dakota was part of the Louisiana Purchase in 1803. Dakota Territory was formed in 1861, and on November 2, 1889, South Dakota became the 40th state, 117 years before the vote on abortion. Abortion was outlawed by the Dakota Territorial Legislature in 1877, and that remained the law when South Dakota became a state. In 1898, South Dakota became the first state to grant its citizens the right to draft their own laws and put them on the ballot, known as the initiative, and the right to use the ballot to challenge laws passed by the legislature, known as the referendum. Abortion was a non-issue for most of a century.
I didn't have that issue at all when I ran for the House in 56 or 58 or for the Senate in 1960. It was never raised in any campaign I was in until 1962. Even in 62, it really wasn't much of an issue, but it was raised in that campaign. When I was running for president in 1972, they called me the candidate of the three A's: amnesty, acid, and abortion.
As George McGovern made his bid for the presidency, a group known as South Dakota Right to Life took shape. The Dakota Territory law banning abortion had stayed on the books until the United States Supreme Court handed down the Roe v. Wade decision on January 22, 1973.
Good. I move we
Before adjourning a few weeks after the ruling, the South Dakota legislature passed what restrictions were allowed under the new legal framework and passed its first of three resolutions asking Congress to amend the Constitution to outlaw abortion.
I remember when I was a little boy. I think it was a Saturday morning. I believe I was watching cartoons in Hoven, South Dakota. And there was a knock on the door. And Mom went and answered it. And I asked who it was when she came back in. And she said, well, it was a group of pro-life people going around and encouraging others to be pro-life. I mean, that was my very first exposure.
In 1979, the South Dakota legislature voted to rescind its earlier ratification of the Equal Rights Amendment, in part because of questions about whether the ERA would guarantee abortion rights.
If 38 states would ratify the Equal Rights Amendment, it would lock abortion into the Constitution, and we could never repeal it. And it took me 6 years to rescind the Equal Rights Amendment. And three times I lost by one vote. So then in 1978, and I told myself, this is not going to work. You have to go out and educate the public in the state. And that year I traveled the whole state from east to west, from north to south. I spoke in 72 towns.
The South Dakota legislature revisited abortion over the years, each time tightening restrictions on the procedure. In 1991, a bill to ban abortions, quote, as birth control, passed the House but failed in the Senate by a single vote.
In 91, we would have had the vote in the Supreme Court. But our bill lost by one vote in the Senate.
The 1990s also saw pro-life groups with national agendas and fundraising set up shop in South Dakota. During that era, Planned Parenthood opened its doors and pro-life protesters blocked the entrance to an abortion clinic.
How could this be happening to us in 1991?
In Sioux Falls, anti-abortion protesters are engaging in something called Operation Rescue, a nationwide effort to prevent women from entering clinics to have an abortion. KELOLAND's Jessica Armstrong is standing by at the office of Dr. Buck Williams, who performs abortions in Sioux Falls. Jessica?
Jay, less than two dozen people are standing in front of the doors right now, but this morning at around 8 o'clock, there were well over 100 people blocking the doors at this Sioux Falls office. At first, the demonstration was a solemn one. We have all kinds of people, housewives, clergy. Bishop Paul Dudley from the Sioux Falls Catholic Diocese is here as well today, and at this moment is sitting in front of the door blocking one of the doors.
A dozen years later, 31-year-old legislator Matt McCulley introduced a bill to ban abortions.
It appears to me that under the Roe v. Wade framework, South Dakota has done all we can do in terms of limiting the number of abortions.
South Dakota.
Besides directly challenging Roe v. Wade, the bill also challenged the time-honored tactic of slowly chipping away at abortion rights. Two pro-life groups, Right to Life and Eagle Forum, fought the bill out of fear that a defeat in court would be a setback to their cause.
Some people, they think we have to do something with abortion. That's not the key to just do something. You have to have the bill, either the bill should be written very tightly or wait until we have the votes in the Supreme Court. And right now, all we need to do is work very hard to have a pro-life president elected and get our Senate back in Washington.
As in 1991, the abortion ban failed by a single vote in the Senate. this time after it had first passed both the House and Senate. But Governor Mike Rounds sought a change in the language through a technical and usually minor bit of protocol called a style and form veto.
And that's not really a veto of the content or intent.
And so the bill died by one vote, and that was the end of the story in 2004 for House Bill 1191.
After the high-stakes drama surrounding the proposed abortion ban in 2004, a bill to set up a task force to study abortion passed easily and quietly. When the task force began its work on August 1st, it was barely noted in the press.
That task force was made up of Republicans and Democrats, men and women, not just legislators, but people from all walks of life.
Any notion that the abortion study was even-handed would be naive, given the way that the committee was put together.
The task force concluded that to fully protect the rights, interests, and health of the mother and the life of her unborn child, a ban on abortions is required.
There was nothing about the task force that was fact-based. When we recommended to the task force that all the research included in the task force process be research that was published in a peer-reviewed journal with all sources of funding cited, which is very standard. If you're doing research-based task force type of work, that's what you do. You don't just allow people to have opinions and put that into your report, and that's what we had. They completely rejected the idea that we would use true scientific research in compiling this report.
My first experience with abortion was when I was 16. And I remember sitting in the driveway of a friend's house who had just had an abortion. And there were probably five or six of us girls sitting in the car. And we all knew when we were going there why we were going there, because she had just had an abortion, and one girl ran in to see how she was doing. And I remember sitting in that vehicle, and there wasn't six girls or five girls talking, chit-chatting about how everything was going. It was silence. And I knew right then and there that what was going on with the young woman inside the house wasn't right, even though at the time I thought it was a woman's choice, you know. But the silence and the feeling that I had sitting in that vehicle, knowing what had just happened to this young woman, wasn't a positive thing for her life.
With the controversial and contested task force findings as its underpinning, the 2006 abortion ban bill hit a tense South Dakota legislature.
House Bill 1215, an act to reinstate the prohibition against certain acts causing the termination of an unborn human life.
Matt McCulley had not run for re-election. This time, Roger Hunt, an active pro-life legislator, led the charge.
Life begins at the time of conception. That medical knowledge that we have today is 30 years advanced.
We know more about fetal pain. We know more about operations of unborn children in the womb. We know more about post-abortion physical and mental problems than was even conceived, if you would, at the time of the decision of Roe versus Wade.
We also have the recent appointment of two justices to the United States Supreme Court. Two pro-life justices, as I believe it. And interesting enough, we also have a member of the United States Supreme Court who was born in 1920, Justice Stevens. This year will be 86 years of age. The only other member of the United States Supreme Court older who served on that court was Oliver Wendell Holmes, who did it until age 90.
While the abortion ban passed by lawmakers in 2004 contained a narrowly drawn health exception, the 2006 bill made no outright exceptions. Instead, it said doctors would not be guilty of a felony if their efforts were, quote, designed to prevent the death of the pregnant mother.
In 2006, everybody was united. We had a nice situation here in South Dakota on the pro-life front. Everybody was moving forward together. All those wounds had been healed.
There was an awful lot of pressure, especially within the Republican Party. And the theme was repeated to me, if you're a good Republican, you're pro-life.
I was approached by Leslie Unruh. I know I was approached because I was a Democrat and a pro-life Democrat and a woman. I know for a fact, because I think that a lot of people out there wanted to squash this image that if you're a Democrat, you are automatically pro-choice. If you're a woman, you're automatically pro-choice.
An unborn child has its own identity, its own DNA. It's a separate human being, not a piece of tissue.
As House Bill 1215 moved through committees and floor action.
My name is Megan, and I was raped. I became pregnant because when I woke up, I had had an abortion. They were told it was a blob of tissue.
When we have a family gathering, there's a chair that's empty.
House Bill 1215, having received a majority vote of the members-elect, is hereby declared passed.
An army of anti-abortion lobbyists marched through the Capitol halls, accelerating the bill's momentum.
I've referred to it as a legislator walking through a gauntlet of lobbyists. And to be honest, in South Dakota, it was certainly not on the pro-choice side. There are lobbyists for the Eagle Forum, for Concerned Women of America, who are there daily. There's folks lobbying for the Catholic diocese, for certainly right to life.
There were times where it was almost like walking a gauntlet in peer, because of the fact that you'd walk the halls and you would literally have people grabbing and stopping you and basically telling you, listen, you know, if you don't vote for House Bill 1215, you're not pro-life. There were certain individuals that indicated that if I didn't support House Bill 1215, they would work to make sure that I lost my seat in the legislature.
What lobbyists do is they stand at that window when they're looking for a legislator, and they literally peer in through that section of glass looking to see which door the legislator's leaving from. There were literally enough people to kind of guard all the exits. And so if you've got that kind of numbers, and frankly, the opposition did, they could post people at just about every exit and wait for the legislator to have to leave.
I had people following me in the bathroom in the legislature. And these people relentlessly hounded us from our desks to walking in the hallways. I had a lobbyist tell me that they said, Senator, if you vote for this bill, it will cost you the election.
They would try and approach you like I didn't have a clue who they were and what they stood for and what they were going to lobby me about. You know, which I just kind of had to think, well, you know, I was born in the night, but it wasn't last night.
Legislators tried to amend House Bill 1215 to allow abortions to protect the pregnant woman's health and in cases of rape and incest. 9 months later, the election would turn on these very questions.
I have to live with myself, and if it doesn't have those compassionate exceptions, I couldn't vote for it.
We tried several times to get the rape and incest exceptions put on the bill, and to no avail.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I have an amendment at the desk.
So I offer you this amendment.
I have an amendment at the desk.
Lawmakers backing House Bill 1215 relied on a rarely used procedural move to cut off debate of proposed amendments. In the South Dakota legislature, once a motion is made to table a bill, debate ends and a vote is taken immediately.
Move to lay on the table Amendment 1215.
I move to table.
Aye!
Those opposed, nay?
No!
Motion carried. 1215 is so tabled.
The tabling is a very hostile act. It says we're not going to even debate this. We're not going to let everybody stand up and talk, and we're going to take care of this. We'll just table them. And on something that major, to make the kind of decision that this was not worthy of extensive debate was, that's offensive to me.
Supporters of the abortion ban were determined to reject amendments because they wanted an uncluttered legal case to take to the Supreme Court, and they worried about how such exceptions would work in practice.
As I sit here today, it's easy to say we should have an abortion ban with exceptions or provisions for life, health, rape, and incest, and those four difficult circumstances. When you start to draft legislation and start to draft a Supreme Court opinion, how do you define what is the health of the mother? Is it objectively? Is it subjectively? Is it mental health? Is it physical health? And so one of the concerns from the pro-life movement over the years has been, how broad should the exceptions be? My view is, let's worry about the exceptions later.
Now, we could have obviously written a bill which said there is an exception for rape, which would then have, in my opinion, opened the proverbial barn door for all kinds of exceptions to the extent that what would happen when a woman walked into the Planned Parenthood clinic would be the first question asked, have you been raped? And when the answer would come out, obviously, yes. Okay, now we can give you an abortion.
After the battle played out in protocol and procedure, it was time for floor speeches and voting.
Given the technological leaps and bounds since 1973, we can conclude with 100% certainty that upon fertilization, a completely new, genetically unique life with its own DNA fingerprint is created.
Life is something we have a sworn responsibility as members of this institution to protect.
Am I extreme? Because I believe that abortion should not be available on demand? Am I extreme because I believe that abortion should not be used as a means of birth control?
There are a number of us that have a fixation on upholding the Constitution of the United States.
Although I may be in a minority today, I can tell you, outside this Capitol and throughout South Dakota, there is a silent majority.
We are once again at the place where the hard rock of religious belief shatters the fragile glass of tolerance. As I see it, the key to the religious issue is where in the process of human development God infuses the soul, giving humankind its truly unique role in God's creation.
Andrew Jackson left a quote, and I'm going to read that quote to you. Each public official who takes an oath to support the Constitution swears he will support it as he understands it, not as it is understood by others.
Greenfield, Hanson Tom, Hanson Gary, Hunstead.
When Governor Mike Rounds signed House Bill 1215, it was international news.
There are days I regret sponsoring the bill, being the prime. I really do, because of the backlashes and some of the very personal comments that were made. And then, of course, I look at the amendments that were offered, and there were, ones that did take care of putting into about the life and the rape and the incest. I guess in hindsight, they would have been probably good amendments to go ahead and put on. They could have made the bill a little bit more palatable. In looking back, I think I would have probably changed my vote on the issues of health of the mother.
Several years ago, when I was in college, I ended up at our state's lone abortion clinic with a past girlfriend. We were so embarrassed, so ashamed, we didn't park at Planned Parenthood. We parked at the Taco Bell next door and walked across. Kind of knew there was something wrong with what we were doing, but still, it was illegal. You know, we didn't hear a lot about it. You know, at that time, it wasn't a huge issue in our state and around the country. Nobody was really there to tell us we should consider adoption, which nobody ever told us, and we kind of thought that was our only option. So I ended up at that abortion clinic and sat in a waiting room. And that's the thing that disgusts me to this day. I sat in a waiting room. I read a Sports Illustrated magazine while my child was being destroyed in some back room. Fathers are supposed to be there for their kids, for their family, and I was no father. I like to say I would like to say I have an abortion testimony from a man's point of view, but I wasn't a man at all.
If the legislators actually thought they were banning abortions in South Dakota, the vote would have been considerably different. They thought they were sending a court case to the justices, and that's a different vote than something that they really believed was going to take effect.
Those who wrote South Dakota's abortion bans had indeed crafted legal, not practical, arguments. They were legal arguments about civil rights, attempting to grant civil rights to the developing fetus, where rights are not now afforded, and redefining the civil rights of the pregnant woman.
Born and unborn should enjoy the same equal protection of the law and due process of law, not having their life, liberty, or property taken without due process of law.
If you look at the Constitution, it says nothing about abortion. In fact, it says just the opposite, that the government is duty-bound to protect the right to life. Now, the discussion then hinges on what is life.
How we define who is a human being legally, because the legal definition of a human being is what provides that human being with all the constitutional rights that a person receives.
What the Supreme Court talked about in Roe versus Wade was, when does legal personhood attach? The Supreme Court decided very, very quickly that the issue of when does it become a human being ensouled, when does the soul enter the body, these are all religious questions. Legal personhood is what the court looked at, and it reached a very simple conclusion very early on, that in Western civilization, we have uniformly attached legal personhood at birth.
If you read the Roe decision, you'll see that the Supreme Court knew the biology and the basic genetics and still ruled as they did. The court said in their decision, "We need not resolve the difficult question of when life begins. When those trained in the respective disciplines of medicine, philosophy, and theology are unable to arrive at any consensus, the judiciary, at this point in the development of man's knowledge, is not in a position to speculate as to the answer."
And even the Roe opinion said, look, if that unborn child is a person, then this is an easy one, because they've got the rights under the 14th Amendment and that fetus is going to be protected.
There are a lot of people in South Dakota who believe that a fertilized ovum is a person.
We do have laws on the books that already do consider that as a second person.
If a woman was sentenced to the death penalty, or was convicted of a crime, and she was given the death penalty, and she was pregnant, under South Dakota law, that execution is stayed until she gives birth to that child. There are other cases under South Dakota law where if someone attacks a pregnant woman and kills the unborn child, that attacker can be charged with a felony, with fetal homicide. So we, in many cases in the law, recognize the personhood or the separate existence of that life within the mother. And under South Dakota law, that life is presently protected from virtually everyone except the mother. We've really moved past the is it a fetus? Is it some blob of tissue that's forming? And you've even now got Supreme Court justices, Justice Kennedy, talking about the life inside of the mother. And so for me, personhood isn't that much more of a step, saying that that child now has constitutional rights to equal protection and due process. The more you know about abortion, the less you like it. And the more you know about what actually goes on, the less you like it. The same was true with slavery. The same is true with segregation. The more facts were presented to the court finally had to say, enough. We were wrong, we're gonna make it right. That unborn child is a person, end of story. Then you get rid of abortion nationwide.
This bill, not only in its title, refers to unborn children, but also to the protection of the health of women as well. That's part of Article 6 of our Constitution. Protect the life and the health of the people in the state of South Dakota.
To succeed in their quest to grant full legal rights to those in utero, abortion ban supporters would have to thread the needle of a legal doctrine key to the Roe versus Wade decision, the right to privacy.
Everything starts with Griswold, which is not talked about as much because it's culturally accepted. Griswold was a Supreme Court decision that found that the state of Connecticut could not ban a married couple from talking to their doctor about birth control. And what it found was that there was a privacy right and an within the family, that the Bill of Rights had a number of things in it designed to guarantee personal privacy for your body, your home, your family.
Griswold, yes, did identify the right to privacy in the context of the Constitution. The right to privacy is not textually in the Constitution, but you can certainly argue that it's there. I don't think anyone's disputing that. The question is, how broad is that? Does the right to privacy extend to allow the taking of an innocent unborn human life because somebody else believes it's inconvenient for them to have that life?
In crafting their legal arguments with an eye to overturning Roe versus Wade, anti-abortion activists in South Dakota have advanced a new argument that would seem to turn the abortion debate on its head, an argument that fits on a bumper sticker: abortion hurts women.
The research we've seen and that we were presented, the legislature was presented with in 2004, said there were two victims to abortion, the unborn human life and the mother.
Roe versus Wade was premised, I think we all need to remember, on what abortion did for women, but it did not address what abortion does to women. We're talking of protecting the relationship between a mother and an unborn child.
The argument is that abortion hurts women in two ways. It causes them psychological and emotional problems afterwards, and it deprives a pregnant woman of a relationship with her child. A relationship, the argument goes, that is constitutionally protected.
They stopped talking about the woman as this irresponsible, evil person who would murder her own baby. And they started coming up with this argument that she is being victimized by this. One year they advanced pretty firmly the argument that she should not be allowed to forego her associational rights to her child until she could hold the child in her arms because she wouldn't know what she was giving up.
American Psychological Association, American Psychiatric Association have repeatedly concluded that there is no research to support the idea that women are harmed by abortion.
And all that right to associate, to form a family that is constitutionally protected, grows out of the decision in Griswold and Roe. Very interesting this session to see them hinging their argument on something that in order to overturn Roe versus Wade, they're gonna have to argue doesn't exist.
Despite a lack of scientific studies to document harm caused to women by abortion, the abortion hurts women argument has already gained traction in the U.S. Supreme Court. In writing the 2007 decision upholding the congressional ban on partial birth abortion, Justice Anthony Kennedy noted that there was, quote, no reliable data, but went on to write, it is self-evident that a mother who comes to regret her choice to abort must struggle with grief more anguished and sorrow more profound when she learns only after the event what she once did not know.
One of the things that was very stressful to me in the last session was one of my daughters was pregnant, and she had a very difficult pregnancy, and she had antibodies that they said at about 4 months, they told her, you know, first of all, we don't know if you'll be able to carry this pregnancy much further, and if you do, it will be at a risk to yourself as well as to the baby. When I thought about 105 people schlopping their way through the legislative process, having a red button and a green button, thinking that they're going to push a button and decide a policy that potentially would take my daughter's decision-making power away. Who cares more about her or the baby she carried? Do they or do we? Those are some of the pictures that we just got today. You know, she's fine, but it was Rachel's decision whether or not she would take that risk. If you don't believe in abortion, don't ever have one under any circumstances, and you are free to lay down your life for that fetus if that's what you feel you must do. We can't know every person's situation. We can't bear that baby for her.
I think that for a lot of voters, they're not one-issue voters in South Dakota. They never dreamed the legislature would actually do something this extreme.
After the governor signed the abortion ban into law, people opposing it took to the streets, at first in small groups, and then in larger throngs. And people supporting the ban responded in kind.
None of us likes abortion. But there are many, many of us who believe it has to stay legal, particularly in those extreme circumstances. I can't in good conscience support a law that forces women who've already had violence done to their bodies to carry a baby to term.
I refuse to say the word fetus, zygote, embryo. It's a baby from conception. Definitely, I think it's murder.
The abortion ban captured the public's attention, and a petition drive got underway to put House Bill 1215 on the November ballot.
It's purely to get it on the ballot so that the people of South Dakota can vote on it.
South Dakota's political insiders viewed that as a risky move for pro-choice activists. Voters might support the ban.
A very common belief on both sides that, of course, out here, everybody's against abortion. When you stop talking about that simple yes, no, and start talking about the realities of medicine, of women's lives, of what happens, people come off of that pretty quick. Do you think that your wife should have to carry a pregnancy if doing so is going to put her in a wheelchair? Or if she was raped? Or any of those things. And they want government out of that decision pretty dang fast.
There were a lot of conversations being held about, is this the state we really want to live in? You know, has this state gone so far to the right that we can't ever get it back? And if we're going to stay here, we're going to do something about it.
I could think of one gentleman I talked to who initially I said, do you want some? And he said, oh no, you know, it would get me in trouble with my family. Called me a week later, his wife's coffee group wanted petitions and it said, don't you know how to get any?
Key anti-abortion figures were nervous too. They had planned arguments for the Supreme Court, not the court of public opinion.
The 2004 legislation was drafted with an audience of the Supreme Court, with no real analysis given to how would this discussion happen in terms of the statewide level.
On May 30th, House Bill 1215 became referred law 6. South Dakotans would become the first Americans to cast ballots on abortion. The abortion ban would face a test it had not been designed to pass.
It could take a couple weeks for the Secretary of State to validate the almost 17,000 signatures needed to put the abortion ban on the November ballot.
In 2006, South Dakotans would vote on gay marriage, medical marijuana, the day school would start, a radical revamp of its judicial system, a governor, a property tax overhaul, a pay raise for legislators, a cell phone tax break, a tobacco tax hike, a repeal of video lottery, and a ban on the governor's personal use of the new state jet. The abortion ban consumed all the campaign oxygen.
Is this the first election that I can ever remember in 20, 30 years that there's no interest in candidates, there's nobody excited about who's running, that this is all about ballot issues, and really it's all about six.
There's a little neighborhood pub not far from my house that I commonly refer to as my campaign headquarters. I've been contacted and said, hey, come on down. We want you to take and go over all these ballot measures and what's going on and explain them to us. And we sit around in a big circle, and I hand out little pieces of paper that I call them the cheat sheets so that they can just put like numbers and letters and how they're going to vote. I don't tell them how to vote, but I explain each and everything that we've got on the ballot this time. And you'll go down and they have questions and discussion about all these issues until you get to the abortion issue. And I explain to them, if you vote yes, it does this. If you vote no, it does that. No one says a word. They each make their little mark and wait for me to go on to the next one.
With the abortion ban on the ballot, its supporters work to persuade voters to keep the new law in the books.
Help us to get the message out that the legislature got. We must have an educational campaign between now and November. We need you. We need you to show up like you've never shown up before.
Crowds of protesters filled the normally quiet streets, and the faithful filled arenas as anti-abortion figures of national stature pushed for victory.
Yes, Lord, we call out to you this morning. We thank you that on November the 7th, the right choice is going to be made. You set before us life and death, blessing and cursing. We choose life. We choose life, God, by your grace.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, as we gather here at the foot of Mount Rushmore, thank you for the freedom you have given us to freely assemble and then to vote as directed by our conscience. We're reminded of our South Dakota state motto, under God, the people rule. May the decisions we make in the next days as a state truly reflect your will and your kingdom's reign.
And the question is, what kind of people are we? What are the values that we represent? What is right and what is wrong?
For God and our posterity, they must know that we shall pray and work and live and vote and fight, but we shall never surrender. Amen.
My biological mother went to a place called Planned Parenthood, which I'm sure you've heard of them. A saline abortion is a saline salt solution that is injected into the mother's womb. The baby gulps that solution. It burns the baby inside and out. I was that baby that she aborted, ladies and gentlemen, but by the grace of God, after being burned alive in my mother's womb for approximately 18 hours, I arrived alive and not dead.
I want to thank all of you for standing up for the right for women to make the best choice with their families when it comes to what happens to them and their body and their reproductive rights. Thank you very much. very much for that.
Stand up, South Dakota! We have to stand up against the people who are wanting to endanger the lives of our sisters, our friends, our daughters, our granddaughters. We can't tolerate it.
Churches and preachers organized on both sides of the issue.
The Family Policy Council has gathered well over 500, closer to 600 different churches around the state of South Dakota to register voters. Make sure everybody in their church is registered to vote.
God of us all, we are gathered here today. We've been led to see that referred law number 6, the law which would ban almost all abortions in our state, is neither just nor compassionate.
As the campaign cranked up into full gear, both sides focused on the question of exceptions for rape, incest, and the health of the pregnant woman.
I was there that day the 1215 came before us. There were no exceptions for rape, for incest. There were no exceptions for the health of the mother. Amendments were made. They were brought up to the floor, and they were refused by the body. There was never any intention of including them.
To add an exception for rape and incest actually weakens the bill legally. It's pretty hard to stand before the Supreme Court and argue that we as a state have determined that life begins at conception, therefore we have the duty and the right to protect that life, and then turn around and say, but not if it's the result of rape or incest.
Out of the 815 reported abortions in the last each year for the last several years, less than 2% of the reasons given for those abortions was because of rape or incest.
I think the spin from the pro-life position is the fact that there are exceptions for rape, incest, and health of the mother, and there really isn't. You know, there are some very specific language within that bill that says that you can, it does not outlaw the use of the morning after pill. But that's not an exception. You can already do that now.
A few weeks before the election, the Vote Yes for Life campaign sent out this flyer saying referred law 6 included rape, incest, and health exceptions.
They specifically say a pregnant woman who is the victim of rape or incest can have an abortion under this law, which is not true. It's an outright lie. The law prohibits pregnant women from having an abortion unless their death is imminent, period.
This is just factually inaccurate. Says we'll have an option of terminating pregnancies that are a result of rape and incest. It's just not true.
It says, under this law, women have the option of terminating pregnancies that are the result of rape and incest. Well, that's just not true. That's a lie.
Well, my first thought was, is this truly vote yes for life? Because it's just not true. That's a flat out wrong. Under this law, women have the option of terminating pregnancies that are a result of rape and incest. I read that and I don't see anywhere in the law that allows for that.
When people are telling me that there is no provision for rape and nothing for the health of the woman in essence, and when I was one of several who drafted the bill, and know how we drafted it, and to say that we are not being truthful, I have to disagree.
Despite Representative Hunt's insistence, the flyer inaccurately portrayed what would be allowed under referred law 6. When it came time to debate over a health exception, doctors campaigned as vigorously as any political candidate, and they fought on both sides of the issue.
This measure does provide exception for the life and the health of the mother.
They say, well, abortion's unhealthy, so this ban is healthy for the mother, so that's the exception, but that makes no sense. That's logically it's logically flawed. And
we had a patient in this area who had strokes exclusively during her pregnancy. We physicians are placed in the unconscionable position of either treating our patients in a medically appropriate fashion and being prosecuted as criminals under this ban, or not treating appropriately and not only facing claims of negligence, but worse, seeing our patients suffer.
All of us as physicians have had the opportunity to take an oath to uphold life, to respect life, and above all, do no harm.
No South Dakota physicians do elective abortions. Therefore, no South Dakota physicians would be prosecuted under referred law 6. The only elective abortions done in South Dakota are done by four physicians from Minneapolis brought in by Planned Parenthood weekly to Sioux Falls.
We treated all these women before 1973, and I think that we somehow have shifted from thinking we have two patients to all of a sudden thinking we have only one patient.
Citing a myriad of potential health problems for women, the South Dakota section of the American College of Physicians and Gynecologists was the only doctors group to go on record officially calling for the repeal of the abortion ban.
Radiation therapy and chemotherapy, which are the mainstays of treatment for cancer, are contraindicated in pregnancy and would be lethal to a pregnancy. Heart disease. There are a number of young women with heart disease, pre-existing heart disease, with in certain conditions, pregnancy can cause heart failure, kidney failure, severe preeclampsia, severe high blood pressure, other anomalies like chromosomal anomalies like trisomy 18, trisomy 13, are associated with multiple fetal anomalies that are not compatible with survival after delivery.
Women with severe diabetes or severe cardiac disease, I guess I would say that it seems to me that it's good medical practice and probably standard medical practice that these women ought to have a tubal ligation before they had any chance of getting pregnant.
The law doesn't address the location of the pregnancy. In fact, it defines the beginning of a human life at the point of fertilization, and that occurs in the fallopian tube. So it doesn't say that a pregnancy outside the uterus or inside the uterus is accepted. It doesn't address that. So unless you remove the ectopic pregnancy to prevent the death of the mother, then that could be construed as a felony. Certainly hemorrhaging to death is one of the complications of an ectopic pregnancy. But I suppose that would have to be tested in court.
Most instances, you actually remove the tube and the pregnancy. And we've always done that, and I don't know why that would be any different now.
Yeah, my question was, what about ectopic pregnancies, tubular pregnancies? If you have a ectopic pregnancy, under the definition of House Bill 1215, it is a pregnancy. And also under the definition of House Bill 1215, if you remove that ectopic pregnancy, that is an abortion. When I went to some of the main supporters of the bill, I specifically asked this question. I said, how does it address ectopic pregnancies? And I gave the scenario. And they said, it doesn't allow for it. And I said, why not? And they said, and I make sure I get this quote, because it would weaken our case when it comes to appeal.
He's like the funniest kid in the world. I mean, he's so smart. Some of the things he says is just, it just makes me smile every day. He does something to make me smile every day. I'll tell him I love him. He goes, I love you this much. And he goes to wrap it around him, And then he goes, I love you from the earth to the moon. I mean, it just like melts your heart. When I first found out, I was 18 years old, and I was really scared, and I didn't know what to do. I cried, of course. It was horrible. I mean, what do you do? You're 18 and still in high school, and I'm scared. Because I wanted to go to college and do something with my life. I don't believe in it, I don't, but put yourself in those shoes. 18 years old, still in high school. You think about it, it was a thought. And I was still, I wanted to do it. But by that time, the ultrasound said I was 4 months along right at that time, so it was too long. But otherwise, I probably would have done it, but That's why I never told anyone. I was scared and I didn't want people to judge me. That's what people did, so. If I went to even get condoms or pregnancy tests, I wouldn't do it here. No. Because I would be like, oh, well, Leslie is check to see if she's pregnant, you know, because it gets around fast. People talk. Everything was going fine, all of a sudden his heartbeat dropped, nothing. And so it was really nerve-wracking and scary because I didn't know what was going on, and they had me prepped for a C-section and everything, and they had to put a probe on his head and monitor him and everything like that. So, I mean, it was really scary. But, I mean, it was the coolest thing ever. Just amazing. So, thank God everyone supported him. So. And there was people, older people in town, you know, the older generation, you know, if you're not married, it's a complete disaster, or, you know, some people did talk about it, but and my dad always says, if someone's talking about you, they're leaving someone else alone, so. I guess you could say I'm pro-choice. I think it's a good choice, depending on the circumstances. Like my circumstance, it would have been really stupid. It's my fault. Even though we did use protection, but, you know, I knew the risks. If you're just gonna be having sex, you know, you need to know what's gonna happen. But I mean, rape, incest, you know, all that stuff, I can see it happened. This is what I get for what I've done. It's a consequence, and I'm gonna own up to it, so. No, we weren't, like, dating. We were hanging out for a while and stuff. Mm-hmm. The first time he ever took him overnight was when he was over 4 months old. I lived in the same town with him he was born August, and then I moved the next August. So he, you know, I lived with my parents and everything that whole year, and he knew where I lived. He knew my number, and he never really stopped. He stopped over the day I came home from the hospital, held him for 2 seconds, and then left. He's just, I don't think he was a baby person, but he loves kids. Mm-hmm. So when Jackson got older, then he started being like, oh, okay, well, this is a lot better. I'll have to change a diaper. You know, he takes him a lot more now because all I gotta do is feed him. Yeah. And he goes to the bathroom by himself. So let's go to college in August. Start August 23rd. I was going for physical therapy. So kind of change that. You can go to college whenever you need to, and I do plan on going back. I mean, it's all in your mind. If you want to go, you're going to go. I would wake up at 6 o'clock in the morning, take a shower, get Jackson out, go to daycare, go to school from 8 to 1:30, and then I go to work full-time from 2 to 10. And during that time, one of my friends would pick him up and watch him. And then, I would go home and go to bed. I didn't have any time to study. Daycare is not cheap. It's not cheap at all. I think I paid about $400 a month for daycare. You've got diapers, you've got formula, you've got clothes. It's really, really expensive. It's not cheap. Growing up, both my parents worked, and I just figured, work. So I didn't want to take advantage of the programs. And, you know, it took a lot of my friends to persuade me to even do it. Like, Leslie, you could use the help. I'm like, well, you know, it's benefiting Jackson. It's for him. Who cares what people say? I need to make the paperwork a lot easier. I tell you that much. Paperwork is not fun to go through. That was my biggest thing, you know. I did apply for daycare assistance. But by the time I got done with all the paperwork and doing all this and doing all that, I was just like, no, forget it. Within the next 5 years, I'll be back down in Sioux Falls. Down there, there's just away from the gossip and away from the, you know, small town drama. You don't really know what it's like until you go through with it. Because it's not a decision anyone wants to make. I don't ever want to go through it again. I'm really glad I didn't. You know, I have a lot of regrets in my life, and thank God that's not one of them. So.
There is a sense all across South Dakota that there's a need to take our state back. put our state back on track. Want South Dakota's legislature to get back on track, to get focused on jobs and income levels, on farm and ranch issues, on wages, on health care, on education, and all the range of issues that really matter to South Dakota families.
That's the abortion ban law, which has no exceptions for victims of rape or incest.
The law contains rape and incest options. And
there's an amazing amount of work right now to be done. We are on the phones, we are talking to our county coordinators, and we're helping them in their counties. And there's a time here of great excitement in the campaign office. The killing stops here in South Dakota.
Just wanted to stop and remind you how important it is to go out and vote tomorrow and to vote no for referred law 6.
We're down to nitty gritty, canvassing, doing the GOTV, reminding people to vote, checking to see if they need a ride, you know, to the polls, you know, the kind of routine things that go into those last 48 hours in a campaign. The polls sound good, but I say polls don't vote.
I'm just calling to remind you how important it is to vote no on referred law 6 today.
It was time for the voice of South Dakota's voters to be heard.
Here now we've got a real chance to make such a wonderful, enduring legacy. It is such a positive statement for babies. We are so excited. And you know, quite honestly, if California and New York want to abort themselves out of existence, go for it. But here in the heartland, we're saying little people matter.
I feel that a woman has the right to choose. Making an abortion illegal now would be too late in the game. That women who are worthy members of society could die if abortion becomes illegal. And because with me, I have a medical problem that I was told 20 years ago not to have a baby. My choice was have a baby, you may not see it grow up, or don't have a baby and stay healthy your whole life. And I don't want another woman to be in that position.
If we die today and we stand before God, we can at least say we tried to make a difference.
I don't think. Me being a man, I have no right to tell a woman what to do with her body.
I know many people were in favor of the rights of the woman, but I guess I come back to the issue of the rights of the unborn.
I think that this is something that is going to be very difficult to see come to any type of a conclusion that's going to benefit the state.
As the sun set and the polls closed, Campaign for Healthy Families volunteers and other abortion rights activists were ebullient.
It's a great night for the progressive spirit in South Dakota. The South Dakotans are taking back our state.
From Vermilion to Buffalo and from Rapid City to Sioux Falls and from Aberdeen down to Pine Ridge, Democrats have really launched a new era in politics in South Dakota.
When the press declared the Campaign for Healthy Families victorious, the mood went from ebullient to ecstatic.
It does appear that referred law 6 has been defeated.
Pregnant victims of rape, there were no exceptions for pregnant victims of incest, there were no exceptions for pregnant women with medical problems. We knew this was an extreme bill and we knew that we had to fight it.
I think it sends a very, very strong message to the legislature and the governor that, you know, we've had enough. This was not a close election. We soundly defeated this and pushed them back.
It's a good night for South Dakota. This South Dakotans today sent a statement out. They decided today that the government's not allowed to intrude into their private lives, that the government is not allowed to make healthcare decisions for women. I don't know if you can call this a red state anymore.
While some pro-life activists expressed disappointment and sadness at their loss, Leslie Unruh, a key leader of the Vote Yes campaign, took to the airwaves vowing to never concede defeat.
We are never conceding. We are never giving up. We have women here that are strong. I'll tell you what is extreme. What is extreme is killing unborn children. We've seen babies saved through this process. These are the heroes. You look at the women in the pink shirts that say alive. These women are alive, they have passion, and they are going to be heard, not just in this state, but all over the world.
Despite polls that have shown pro-life arguments finding favor with a majority of South Dakotans and roughly half of Americans, South Dakota's abortion ban proved to be an overreach. An all-out ban remains unacceptable to the general public.
I've always claimed to be pro-life. It wasn't until 2003 when we first had the first bill of McCulley's that a person really had to truly examine what that means.
The 2006 campaign etched more nuance into the abortion debate and rendered the labels pro-life and pro-choice nearly worthless currency in South Dakota's political marketplace.
Before, it was you either are for or against abortion, period. And now it's broadened it out.
When you say you're pro-life, what does that mean? And to what extent? How do you define pro-life, pro-choice?
The definition has changed in pro-life is a pretty broad statement. In fact, they'll ask me if I'm pro-life and then they'll say, how did you vote on the bill? So they get pretty specific. So I think people want to be lumped into a pro-life stance, even if they believe in exceptions.
I am pro-life. I have always publicly stated I am pro-life. What happens so often is these labels that are placed on politicians, are you pro-life, are you pro-choice? You know, to me, I'm very much pro-life, but evidently I'm not pro-life enough.
And those who are not pro-life, some of them try to be pro-life, and it doesn't work.
Just a quick call to remind you.
The 2006 campaign created a network of abortion rights activists across South Dakota, a network that did not exist before and that now rivals what anti-abortion groups had built up.
But this fight has made us so much stronger.
To bring this bill back next year, we're going to stand up and we're going to fight again.
If the people speak, they've spoken. And you, as a representative of the people, as a legislator, you better respect that.
Clearly, the people said in 2006, we want some exceptions.
On January 31st, 2007, less than 3 months after the 2006 election, another abortion ban bill hit the South Dakota legislature.
The House Bill 1293 bans abortion on demand, but it contains well-crafted exceptions for rape, incest, and health of the mother.
This time, the bill itself contained language to put the question directly on the 2008 ballot.
But the polls tell us that if the bill had contained a rape and incest exception, it would have passed by at least 60%, possibly up to 75% of the voters. The message from the voters is clear. They don't want abortion on demand in South Dakota. They don't want abortion as a method of birth control.
As you know, we have just gone through a grueling grassroots campaign. The majority of South Dakotans
share in that fatigue on this issue. They would not welcome another campaign.
With nerves still raw from the 2006 campaign, this new ban passed the House but could muster just one vote in a Senate committee.
They weren't going to do anything with it until the 08 election. There's no reason why it would have to be done this year. They most certainly could take a look once again next year.
Come back next year, they did. Anti-abortion groups have gathered the signatures to put an abortion ban on the 2008 ballot, this time with exceptions. The Campaign for Healthy Families reorganized and went to work, too.
If rape and incest were in there, to the satisfaction of those that's the reason that they won't support the law, if that was in there to their satisfaction, it would pass overwhelmingly.
The feud that hobbled anti-abortion work in 2004 erupted again.
The two sides of the pro-life movement, and I'm not talking at all about the, you know, pro-life versus pro-choice or pro-abortion, I'm talking simply pro-life has two different opinions.
The divide between abortion opponents who want to chip away at Roe versus Wade and those who want to take more aggressive steps is widening.
They felt that they would like to do this in incremental small steps, and I guess, you know, we, after doing the task force, felt that we needed to go all out and not wait for that.
And you just continue to chip away at it till essentially, or in the end, there's really not much of it left. That takes a lot of time, and that's the strategy we've, to a large part, been pursuing since 1973.
They don't think that there's such a thing as nibbling around the edges. They want to end abortion completely, in its entirety, except for that mysterious 72 hours. And they're going for the brass ring.
As abortion rights supporters prepare for another campaign, they can no longer rely on a message about rape, incest, and health exceptions. They now talk of a desire to keep the government out of private decisions and of abortion fatigue while they push lawmakers to focus on other
issues. South Dakotans want the legislature to get back to work dealing with problems that actually affect South Dakotans, you know, like drought relief or property tax relief or education, for God's sake, health care for all, poverty on the reservation.
I think our state needs to heal. It's been a very, it's been torn apart by, you know, a very difficult issue. I don't know that our state can handle another bout of that. The fight on abortion can be set for another venue, another time. Let's move on to some other issues to help the young people, to help our elders, and do some good things for our state. We move on. We try to anyway.
Thank you.